community, and of course, our global family who is tuned in to join us today. I'm Dr. Nadine Rogers, and I'm always so excited and grateful to be able to share the principles of spiritual life with you. Oh, the new theme for March is opening to possibilities, where we get to explore the ebb and flow of spiritual living as an open and receptive conduit for the wholeness of spirit. Here at CSL Parker, we learn how to apply practical spirituality in our everyday lives based upon the teachings of Dr. Ernest Holmes. His teachings are called The Science of Mind and Spirit, and he summarizes these teachings as a correlation of the laws of science, opinions of philosophy, and revelations of world religions. Apply, this is the important part, to human needs and the aspirations of man. Now, we all know that we live in a spiritual universe, and most of us are aware we're spiritual beings having this human experience. But we don't always remember that everything we think we need or lack is always right within us, right where we are. We learn to be a student with humility and awe in the vast power for good within us and within this world. And we come to understand, as we walk each other home, that we teach by how we live, and that how we live becomes our prayer. The Center for Spiritual Living honors all faith traditions. So let us begin our time together by lighting the candle in honor of all these faiths. So we light this candle honoring all paths to God and the universal consciousness of life, which acknowledges that all people in all faiths, all sentient beings, come from the one great universal presence, which we call spirit. Fundamental to this truth is the unifying nature of all diverse faiths, thought, and experience, which again, we honor here today. And you know, as we acknowledge both our multiplicity and our unity, we do come to a beautiful state of inner peace. So knowing that the truth of all life is sourced and present right within each one of us, we know you are blessed right here and now. So sit back and relax and enjoy your time with us today, beginning with what's happening at CSL Parker. Kim, take it away.
Thanks, Dr. Rogers. Good morning, and I hope you all get a chance to get outside today and enjoy the beautiful Colorado weather. We are going to be flirting with 70 today. And don't forget, next Sunday, March 14th, Reverend Phil will be leading the in-person service at Cimarron Middle School. If you're comfortable, right? Woohoo! If you're comfortable attending, it will be a treat to see you there. There will be more details to come about what this service is going to look like. March 21st will be pre-recorded, and March 28th will be a live Zoom service. Stay tuned in today for after chat at 11 o'clock immediately following today's service. This is a great forum to discuss your insights and ask questions about today's message. A new six-week Zoom course entitled The Laws of Love will begin later this month, facilitated by Dr. Byrne. The Wednesday class is now full, but you can still register for the Thursday class that begins March 25th and runs from 10 to noon. The registration link, course fee, and required reading is in the e-blast. And here's another opportunity to learn. Dr. Nadine will be offering a live Zoom four-week class on The Art of Letting Go. The course will run April 1st through April 22nd on Thursday evenings from 6:30 to 8:30 p.m. Watch for more details and the registration link in next week's e-blast. You are welcome and invited to the next Zoom Town Hall meeting on Thursday, March 18th, starting at 7 p.m. The discussion will highlight how our choices inform change and how change informs our experience. Please refer to the e-blast for the Zoom link and passcode. Now, at the end of each service, we have enjoyed Lisa Anderson's photo montage put to inspiring music showing delightful pictures of our members and their families. A new montage will premiere the weekend of the spring solstice, March 21st. If you would like to be included, Lisa would need your horizontal formatted pictures by tomorrow. Monday, March 8th. And no worries if you submit them later, as she will save them for the next one. Thanks so much to Lisa for putting together these enjoyable images. And now let's sit back and enjoy some beautiful music.
The time is right. Swing wide the doors to let in the light. Bring in the dawn for humankind. Swing wide the doors of this heart of mine. Here we go. Ooh. Ooh. Swing wide the doors. The time is right. Swing right the door to let in the light. Bring in the dawn for humankind. Swing wide the doors of this heart of mine. But I'm not holding it in anymore. I'm gonna shout it out loud. I understand now what I'm life is about, what this life is about. Swing wide the doors, the time is right. Swing wide the doors to let in the light. Bring in the dawn for humankind. Swing wide the doors of this heart of mine. Swing wide the doors of this heart.
Hey folks, Reverend Phil here. For our meditation this morning, we have something brand new that has been put together by practitioner Katie MacArthur. So I hope you enjoy this wonderful video that she has produced for our meditation today. And it goes, I just want to caution you, it goes right into meditation. So prepare yourselves now, because we don't have the normal moment that we might have before it.
Allow your body to relax and adjust to a comfortable position. Now become aware of your breath. Breathe gently in. Breathe out. Breathe in. Feel the cool air filling your lungs. Breathe out. Loosening all stress or strain in the body that you may be feeling. Now go deep. Connect to your center. Relax into this moment. Breathe and know Infinite Spirit, the one true source, is the one power and presence that is over all, in all, and through all. The one source is unlimited in its true nature to be the light of hope and joy. We are in unity with the one source of all creation, awakening to all creation. Like an early, cool spring day, hope is budding like a rose in early season. There is a re-energized sense of anticipation, of love rising up. The seed of creation is alive. There is no judgment. There is no fear. Spiritual evolution is occurring. Glory unto glory. You are the light of creation. Know that universal law obeys the will of Spirit, the One. What is to evolve from the present moment? Take a moment and pause. Listen to your center. Listen to your heart. What is your next evolution? What are your next thoughts budding into? Be here now and know love is expressing its nature through you with joy and the hope of what is to transpire. Breathe in love. Breathe out peace. Allow the flow of the one source to run through you. Know the one divine power flows through you. For all is good. All is of God. And we are grateful for this knowledge.
Optimism is contagious. Say it loud and sing it strong. Optimism is contagious. Pick it up and pass it on. Hope is a place where one smiling face can make a difference. Positive messages dance past the edges of doubt. Well, it's a ripple, it's a rhythm, it's a movement, it's the beating of drums. Oh, when you can't help but move to its music when it comes. Optimism is contagious. Say it loud and sing it strong. Optimism is contagious. Pick it up and pass it on. Rocks can be smooth and tides can be moved by the moon. Armies disarmed and snakes simply charmed by you. It's a candle, it's a beacon, it's a comet, it's a constellation. Oh, so let yourself go and bask in the glow of the illumination. Optimism is contagious. Pick up and sing strong. Optimism. Optimism is contagious. Say it loud and sing it strong. Optimism is contagious. it up and pass it on. Pick 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 it up and pass it on.
Oh my gosh, that was fabulous. Oh, I love it. I'm going to be just doing that rhythm all day long. Oh, that was great. And what a creative meditation from Katie. I love the fun, the lightness, and the animation of that. Well, it's perfect because we've started a new month and the theme this month is open to possibilities. Oh, yes. You know, each of us wants to move through life with ease and peace and joy. I think trusting ourselves in the decisions we make. And in order to open to these possibilities, we have to increase our faithful use of the law of mind and action and make it our constant partner and companion. You know, the more we practice, our first go-to becomes the spiritual principle. And then our capacity to morph and adapt to change sets a new confidence in motion. And we start to become receptors rather than resistors of how universal good appears in our lives. So I wanted to begin today in exploring the idea of opening to possibilities through the concept of include and transcend as the highest use of spiritual law. So a long time ago, as a student of life and one who was a spiritual seeker, I was not all that enamored by all those deeper questions that people would ask me or that I would ask of myself. And what I've come to know after these years of practice, that whether we are new or seasoned, we find challenges moving through those deeper questions. And it's been my personal experience, which I know is common among us, that we are not well practiced in the art of dissolving defenses or accepting vulnerability as a way to strengthen our guiding light. Or, you know, generally just letting it be okay for people to see us. You know, the layers go deep, and let's face it, transparency is not humanity's forte. Long before I was called to be a minister, as you all know, I was called to be a clown. Now, neither experience was pre-planned or thought through, but simply the result of having said yes to divine intervention. In other words, I was open to possibilities. Excuse me, even though a part of me was going, do not go there, do not go there, do not go there. Be it known that the principle of wholeness is expressed in all of life's seeming paradox, disguised as the concept of opposition, when, spiritually speaking, it is nothing more or less than sacred complement, the two sides of the same coin. Now, this healing awareness can be more easily absorbed when we bridge, you know, our teaching, metaphysics, science, and spirituality with humor. And the artful process I continue to move through is to reframe perceived shortcomings, embrace my foibles, and even transmute pain by giving them the sacred recognition of their sacred humanity as being a divine expression. So include and transcend, the highest use of spiritual law, include. Now, the concept is more widely known as transcend and therefore include. And how many spiritual teachings and the science of mind interprets it this way, transcend and include, at least in one's initial understanding of its practice. Knowing our true spiritual nature and individualized expression of the one life, of one God, is important so that we can learn to love the self, right? And in science of mind, in this teaching, we use a method in which to do that. It's to train us into that place of the allness and the nothingness, the oneness, the energetic feel of that one life and no separation. And this method is, of course, as you know, affirmative prayer work, or we also call it spiritual mind treatment. And it's a way in which we speak our word to lean us into that greater realm of possibility in our own life based upon what we have chosen to identify as the universal creative process, always demonstrating to move cause into effect or energy into matter. So we begin in this five-step treatment with the idea of recognition, right? In the world of absolute reality, it's all that is. It's called God or divine presence, infinite intelligence. We have many names for it, but we do know it. No matter how we name it, as goodness, wholeness, and unity. It's complete and perfect in its nature of being. And then, because it is all there is, we bring ourselves into the mix in step two and unify with that. Here is where the formula can take a left turn. Mostly because as soon as we use the word I and individualize the one, our mind, our memories, our subconscious belief patterns kick in and respond in that secondary conversation in our heads, where our mouths are moving in a completely opposite direction, like, are you kidding me? God, the Almighty, and I are one and the same. It can break down here because our ego surfaces and we think in terms of personality, individuality, and objectivity. So this is true much of the time, unless we stay with the feeling sense of the energy or frequency we are creating, or that is being co-created, I should say, through the placement of our intention. Now, if we successfully carry this expansive energy, this of unlimited possibility of life, and make it through the second step of unification, then we are better poised to enter the third step, to declare the truth of our being and of the conditions of our lives, or not. You know, it does become progressively harder, that is why they call it spiritual practice, to bring an on-the-ground feeling experience when our emotion could be filled with deep confusion or anger or desire or attachment. So it's very hard to bring an on-the-ground feeling experience up into that same energetic frequency of trust and faith and peace and gratitude of unity. Then for most, if honest, we hit the wall. And we just want to say the last two steps, being grateful and release, you know, quickly releasing the pressure of saying one thing and thinking another. Because that's a lot of what a lot of us do in our daily communication, isn't it? We're not congruent. And I believe after 25 years in this teaching that we need to practice prayer and treatment. And at the same time, practice not letting our focus on this third dimension of the worldly material world, keep us separated from the unified field where all already exists. So here, in other words, I'm changing it around. Include first that seeming paradox, right? Where we feel separated, where we think dualistically, where we see ourselves or the world as either or, this or that. So first include that seeming paradox in our perception, our decisions, our actions, wherever they show up. Then when we accept, transcendence becomes an automatic feeling state. So we don't have to seek to become godlike or Christ-like even. All we need to do is open in the moment now, deep within our feeling state, and accept what is. And then we feel non-resistant and non-divided against ourselves. And we can more readily move into that feeling state of authenticity, and our authentic self is one in God. You know, Jung says emotion is the chief source of becoming conscious. Without it, there can be no transforming of dark into light or apathy into movement. So we need to get beyond ourselves to live in the energy of the unified field. Again, it means accepting the emotional feeling and expression of the dark and the shadow. Now, how I've done this is I've diverted my brain instead of killing the pain. I used to kill the pain. Now I just divert the brain. The best way I know how to do is take myself lightly, have fun, play, feel that innocence and that spontaneity of being like a child, right? In conjunction with the ultimate use of spiritual law, or the recognition of spiritual laws always working in our lives and bringing myself into alignment with the principles behind them. Now, Dr. Holm wrote a book entitled Open at the Top. He said, there's no precedent in principle, which mean in this eternal moment of now, the full creative infinite mind exists and it is using us and we are using it. So it really doesn't matter what has gone before. And yet how often do we live in the present based on the past? How many times have we said or have we heard, well, that's not the way it's done or was done before? Now, Holmes also said, which is probably a very big turning point as a student in the ministry for me, and I'm going to paraphrase it. What I take away and what I talk about mostly is we're not here to leave a legacy or even make a difference. Now, I know that can fall hard on the ears of a great, great and devoted servant, but we're not here to leave a legacy or even make a difference. But we're here to be the full expression of what we, as the unique individualization of the Holy One, have come here to express and therefore experience. So we've got to trust ourselves. You know, we'll do almost anything to survive in a complex societal structure, you know, which says, be in the world, but not of it. Well, again, I'm going to turn that around. Be in the world and love it by embracing our humanity. Replacing our focus from self-improving to self-approving, which brings us back into that and in both reality. We've got to keep asking this question. What is my impact on the rise and fall of the collective consciousness? Because as Holmes says, there's a power for good in the universe and we can use it. So when we use thought and are not possessed by thought, the deep destruction and distraction of the labels that we put upon ourselves to identify ourselves as begin to unravel themselves. You know, I am a religious scientist because I can be all of who I am without apology. Knowing that God is living in, through, and as me, you know, I'm committed to live into these principles because it guides me to experience my true innate nature and the promise or natural outcome of God as the universal creative process, and therefore not just taste freedom, but be free. To be honest, you know, when others ask me what religion I minister to, I sometimes say, really, it's probably the mischievous part of myself, just to lighten things up or throw people off. I say, I teach the religion of more. And they're like, you know, that's really not a good Christian virtue for many, right? It's sacrifice, right? The religion of more, more to be, more to experience, more to share, but not more to know. And in my books, it all begins with more to feel. More about that in a moment. You know, truthfully, I am a religious scientist because when I live into the principles of unity and wholeness and oneness, perfect God, perfect life, perfect man, and I choose to align my thinking and actions with natural spiritual laws, such as cause and effect, the law of attraction, reciprocity, I get to live in the result instead of hanging out in the idea. You know, the religion of more or even feeling more is a challenge, can be a real challenge for us. But in order to be in the world and love it, rather than be in the world but not of it, we must learn to lean into that fine art of embracing the paradox, you know, to believe and dance in the principle of wholeness on both a universal and personal level at the same time. And we can't learn to be not of this world until we have mastered being in this world. And we can't master being in the world until we embrace and accept, have compassion and love for ourselves, our humanity, and all humanity. We need a strong back and a really soft front if we are to be in the world and love it and share the sacred space between life and death with others and be here dancing to the music in between the notes on the conscious journey of our own becoming. I love Zen stories. And there's a story of a Zen meditation student who was living in an enclosure perched above the Dead Sea, listening to the wind in the olive trees. And as he climbed to the rooftop of his zendo, he could see a huge sun emerging from the Dead Sea beyond the desert of Judas. And his Zen master said to him, "You see, O live, olive, O live and dead from the same place." The olive tree illustrates that even when the fruits fall away, the roots are still growing deeper and stronger. To the ancient Greeks, the olive was the mythological tree sacred to Athena, the protectress of wisdom. In the Middle East, the olive is a religious and secular symbol of peace, wealth, and abiding goodness. Though the uncured fruit of the olive itself, this peace is not without its own bitterness. You know, 70 years after the death of Christ, Roman soldiers slashed down the olives of the Garden of Gethsemane, while modern inhabitants of Israel have uprooted thousands of fruiting olive trees, which is the plant of blessing for Islam, relied on for centuries to mark the boundaries of Palestinian land. The olive tree matures slowly over time, yet can remain fruitful for more than 700 years. Isn't that amazing? Apparently, the olive has this uncanny ability to renew itself from destruction and decay for long after an individual tree dies. The plant's massive root ball continues to pump with life, throwing out new shoots for several centuries. You know, they need scant water to get established, yet its hidden roots seek out moisture to a depth of 20 feet. The fruit's taste is strong, as old as water, and just as deep. War and peace together on the tongue, O live and dead from the same source. Many of us are suffering from a case of mistaken identity. So where to begin on the journey to embrace the principle of wholeness, right? Operating as our humanity. Well, just be honest. That would be my number one thing. You know, don't let the excuse of fear stop you from not creating an identity or image, but rather take the awesome journey of discovering yourself. That feels different when you say it like that. Let me say it again more simply. Our journey isn't about being successful at creating ourselves. It is about the discovery of who we have always been. To seek our truth or our true self is often done on the level of the intellect. But to be our true self is an exercise of the heart in which infinite intelligence has its home. Also identify yourself with the feeling in the inner body as much as you can, and move away from the ideas of I or me. Oh my gosh, another place, being congruent with our own values when we set our intentions, right? In our decisions, which of course inform our actions. And when we're not congruent with our values in our intentions, we will reveal that we're often carrying a conscious intention to succeed, but an unconscious intention to fail. And that's why we need to reframe failure. So I'm going to give you a little example from my clowning days about that. You know, I learned that you don't particularly have to be skilled at what you do with regards to your props or your act, right? Your skit. The true challenge I discovered is to tell your story, to tell my story with whatever I'm doing authentically. And then that will capture the audience or others and draw them in subjectively. So right away, I've set up a relationship, an understanding, but they must believe you. For example, I clowned for 22 years. I taught clowning, and part of my clowning course was teaching juggling. Well, no one ever taught me to juggle. I had to teach myself, like most things in life, right? I'm sure you understand what I mean. So I wasn't that coordinated. And I'm not that focused and disciplined to keep practicing a skill over and over and over and over and over until I get it what, right? Yeah. So I knew I had it out because clowns are expected to make mistakes. So you see how that really supported me foundationally in embracing my humanity. So what I ended up doing was creating this 15-minute skit that I actually sold clients for money on juggling. And in 22 years, I could never juggle more than three balls. And don't give me an apple, an orange, and a watermelon. Forget that. So what did I do? Instead of actually impressing people with my juggling, I showed them in the moment my authentic attempts, my concerns, my frustrations, dropping the ball over and over and over again. I would go down to reach for the ball and then my toe of my shoe would just slightly kick it. So it would roll out of my reach. I created amusement. I created laughter. They were feeling it with me. Everything I was feeling, they were feeling. You see, we create an authentic story. So who cares if you can really juggle? That was a really important lesson for my spiritual journey. So let me ask you this. How many of you are familiar with these myths? Pennies don't fall from heaven. Everything has a price. You must follow the rules to fit in. When you don't think of others first, you are selfish. And how many are familiar with these concepts? Honor thyself first. Follow your bliss. The highest and best for me is the highest and best for all concerned, no matter what it looks like. Now, which of those groupings brings you a sense of aliveness? And which ones do you ascribe to in your life? Imagination is what will move us from precedence to originality. There are indeed risks to living on the edge or in the mystery without being in control of every situation. But the ultimate goal of life is not that we shall arrive at that spiritual destination, as you know, because everything remains static and inactive. Life is an eternal upward spiral of existence, crossing the great divide from the relativity of day-to-day life to the marriage of our souls to their source. That's why imagination is vital. We can't afford to believe everything we think because we don't know where those thoughts have been. I love that line. I'm going to say it again because it's fun. Don't believe everything you think because you don't know where your thoughts have been. You know, we're far too often living with a tendency around our own personal evolution and helping to create a world that works for everyone, transcending before we're including. And that can make us sound superior rather than inclusive, which in turn makes us neither. So where might we start this inner conversation that has us take responsibility to heal our own separateness from the nature of being as one, to transcend false belief that has shaped us and our expression for years without excluding any part of the journey along the way? We are walking art. And what I know is the principle of art is that unity occurs when all of the elements of a piece combine to make a balanced, harmonious, complete whole. Unity is another of those hard to describe art terms, but when it's present, your eye and brain are pleased to see it. Now, contrast is also a principle of art. When defining it, our experts refer to the arrangement of opposites. So light versus dark, rough versus smooth textures, large versus small shapes in a piece so that it can create a visual interest and excitement and drama. The colors white and black provide, of course, the greatest degree of contrast. But complementary colors also highly contrast with one another. And an artist, which is what we are, can employ contrast as a tool to direct the viewer's attention to a particular point of interest within the piece. So it's really important for us to always keep in mind that our words are not absolute truth, but they are teaching tools we use to try and better understand truth or reality. In the old Zen terms, there is a statement, our words are but the finger pointing to the moon. Let us not get so caught up in the finger that we miss the moon to which it is pointing. So the highest use of mental practice is to listen to our inner voice and declare its presence. We are not here to analyze or understand what has been. We are here to experience and share the greatest expression of ourselves possible in an infinite field of possibility. As metaphysicians, we need to not want to change everything, but realize the good in all things. And this is how we move from a perception of duality to a perception of oneness. We realize that universal order is to realize there is nothing to be fixed outside or inside of one's experience or expression of this life. And so join me if you would in knowing that to live from that awareness of the one, we accept, we do not want to change the unique individualized expression of the love and the one that we are and are made of. And today, each one of us is moving closer to opening up the possibilities of our own expression, therefore experience of life, by including and embracing all that is through our acceptance and our gratitude, so that we may engender this beautiful feeling of transcendence, or maybe better put, unification of wholeness. Yes, that is the highest use of spiritual law. To listen to that inner voice and to declare its presence. And so I do declare this for each and every one of us. I also know that life is a blessing, or a blessing in disguise, as you may want to term it. And we are a blessing, or a blessing in disguise. It is all good either way. So please join me in grounding this truth for you in your life today. by saying, and so it is. Amen. So now I'd like to invite you into a personal investment. We call it sacred and faithful giving. You know, knowing that there is this beautiful infinite flow of abundance that is operating in and through us as a possibility at all times, no matter our present on the ground conditional experience, we open to expand this consciousness of acceptance by giving with a grateful heart. I really believe that when our souls are fed by the practice of giving in this way with a grateful heart, we can be certain that our gift blesses both the giver and the receiver many times over. We so appreciate your gifts and your tithes. So thank you truly for supporting us at Parker to remain a vital and thriving center in which you can receive your spiritual nourishment. So for your convenience, we provide you with various ways in which you can make your donation. You can donate on our website at www.cslparker.org/donate or via Zelle. Or if you're more comfortable mailing in a check to our office location, here is the address. I invite you now to affirm your prosperity through the power of your word by saying this with me. I attract all good things into being. The power of my faith enhances my experience of health, relationship, finance, fulfillment, passion, purpose, and joy. The creative source in my life is in a constant state of perfection, freely giving itself as my bounty, and so it is. So glad you're connecting with us today. Together we raise the vibration and the energy of love and connection. And now I welcome back Alicia. And Alicia, please introduce your counterpart.
Gary.
Gary, Alicia and Gary in our offering song.
Treasure is what we have to give, it's what we have to share, and how we live. In the law of circulation, just passing on the gift, the talent, time, and treasure, we are blessed. We are blessed. Talent, time, and treasure. What we have to share and how we live. In the law of circulation, just passing on the gift, the talent, time, and treasure, we are blessed. We are
beautiful. So we're going to ask you to join for the after chat. You're going to jump on another Zoom link for that. And Reverend Phil is going to facilitate that for us this morning. Thank you, everyone who volunteered to make today's service happen. It was wonderful. Reverend Phil on the technical aspects of things, Kim, Alicia, and Gary, and Katie. Blessings to everyone. And now let's just join together in our closing benediction. We know truly there is only one power, one life, one perfect life, and that is operating in us as perfect life right here and right now. And so I know that as the sweet spirit calls us forward, urges us, nudges us, we listen. We open to the possibility. We know that there's always a divine intervention happening within us. It is the source expressing itself more fully as we let it and as we receive it and accept it in its expression. As we accept it in its expression, we are therefore accepting us in our expression, because we are the spirit expressing individually by means of us. Knowing that there is no separation, we go forward in our day with a greater sense of peace and joy and sense of fun and lightness about who we are and what life is doing in and outside of us. So grateful for spirit, this great spirit. This great spirit that encompasses all of life, that is us. Please join me in deep gratitude for these words of truth by saying with me, and so it is. Amen. Blessings on your week, Parker.
Sometimes I lay under the moon. I thank God I'm breathing. And I pray, don't take me soon, 'cause I am here for a reason. Sometimes in my tears.